This is a National Arts Center podcast.
Welcome, Timo. Thanks for joining us today.
Nice to be here.
So, we're going to be presenting two of your pieces. Most of the concert, in fact, half the concert is your repertoire for the upcoming Wolfgang on November 19th at the Mercury Lounge. We have Early to Rise and Safe Travels. Now, Early to Rise is a string quartet that I was reading on your website. You constructed it as having four sections, but it's one continuous movement, basically, right?
That's right. And I sort of wanted to write something that felt like it had a bit of the scale of the traditional four-movement string quartet, which is maybe 20, 25, 30 minutes, but compressed into just a 10 or 11-minute chunk of music. And so really how I did that was by making the materials themselves very short. They're kind of each of the four sections based on just a little motto. Mm-hmm. And the way that it moves forward is by sort of pushing that material to a breaking point, at which point it kind of the music flips and the material is transformed into the material for the next section.
Okay. Is this motif or these little cells, are they do they have any inspiration, or are they related to something else, or are these just, is this a piece of material that you came up with for your own?
The first the very first thing that you hear in the piece, which is just a little five note motto played in the violin, that is sort of modeled on a piece by Schumann. His Morning Songs, which was a very, very late piece. I think it might be the final or penultimate piece that he wrote.
Right, it's for piano as well, right?
Solo piano, right. Yeah. Morning Songs or Gesänge der Frühe, if you're German, it's good. I've always been obsessed with the piece, and it's one of my favorite things to play. And it's just this little accompanimental riff in the second movement of that piece, which was sort of the germinating idea for Early to Rise.
Cool. So if you don't mind me saying, I was looking at your website because I was fascinated with what you had to say about this piece and how each section. You have, as you mentioned, each section evolves until it flips, as you said, and these mm-hmm. tipping points you quote on your website. And then you also have instances you were mentioning on your website of like how this evolves to contrary motion, that suddenly the voices move in different directions. And then you finish with a chaconne, right? Or is that in the third section?
The chaconne idea, it's really almost, well, I'm not sure that I would use that word.
Okay.
Anymore.
No, absolutely.
It's really the idea of a chaconne is that you have a repeating pattern that the music is all based on. Chaconne, it would be a harmonic pattern, like the Bach D minor chaconne or the fourth movement of Brahms' fourth symphony. In this, it's a little different because each time the pattern repeats, it modulates. So the modulation that aspect of change is actually built into the material. And that's something that I am very interested in when I'm selecting any type of material is like, what are the possibilities in this that can sort of give rise to an entire musical structure, not just something that sits on the page and might sound pretty on its own, but something that has that little bit of sand in the oyster, you know.
I like that.
That makes the pearl.
Yeah. Okay. That's great. That's a nice analogy. For the other piece on the program of Wolfgang, it's Safe Travels, and you've written this for the incredibly talented and one of my favorite groups, Why Music Ensemble.
Good. I'm glad you're a fan.
Oh, totally. I went to school with half of them, so I know them all well. Yeah. I know Alex very well. Anyway, it's great. It's great. We've been programming a lot of the music actually over the last couple of years that was written for Y Music. It's so mm-hmm. accessible, and it's so interesting and unique and innovative. A lot of the music that the composers were writing for them, it's fabulous music. And so
it's brave though, because a lot of our pieces are so customized for those particular players.
Right, exactly.
It's, well, I don't know too many people. I think, this performance and one other performance, coming up are maybe only the second or third groups
really?
To take that piece up after Y Music. Yeah, because it's so difficult.
I wonder, is this maybe the Canadian premiere of these works? Do you know?
I'm not sure if Y Music has played.
Yeah, they may have toured it here, right? Yeah, exactly.
It's hard to keep track of what they play where, because everything is like a rock show, basically.
Right, no, they're so busy. They're constantly playing with people. It's amazing.
Right.
So Safe Travels, though. Tell us a bit about that piece. And you mentioned that it's uniquely written for them. So what do you mean by that?
Well, these are players who, you know, the idea of having a sextet that is violin, viola, cello, flute, clarinet, trumpet. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is not an ensemble that exists in the world of standard
right.
repertoire. So, you know, the reason that this ensemble came together is because of these six specific musicians mm-hmm. who exist in this very particular type of sort of jumping between lots of different musical pursuits. Mm-hmm. And they all love playing together. And I've been playing with many of them over the years and writing for many of them. And so it was one of those pieces that when I was writing, I was like, you know, I could hear Nadia Sirota's viola in my head or Alex Sopp's flute. And that is always sort of a very, very helpful starting point. When you're trying to come up with an idea for a piece. So it's kind of this intense, like the virtuosity in terms of playing chamber music together, was an idea that I was really interested in. It's like, not necessarily how well can these people play their instrument on their own? Mm-hmm. 'Cause I mean, we know they're all sort of virtuosos in their own right.
They're all super talented.
But what is it about when these people play with each other that is so exciting? And so the level of chamber music playing in this piece is very, very demanding. Mm-hmm. Sort of very quick hockets, which are, you know, passing one musical line around between different musicians.
Can you speak to the difficulty of that, and what is your understanding of the what is your concept of that difficulty for the musicians?
Basically, the idea of dividing up a musical line between players and making it sound, on the one hand, smooth mm-hmm. and rhythmically intact, but on the other hand, getting that changing sound quality that you get by moving it between the different instruments. Right.
Okay, so like the way that the color can change, but you don't necessarily want to know that it's a change in the instrument or the player.
Or that you retain a sense of the musical line being whole.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you're sort of trying to create this new instrument that's built out of multiple instruments. And that, you know, the speed at which that happens in this piece is I think, really quite difficult. Mm-hmm. The other thing that is sort of the main idea behind this piece, and actually a reason I think it's a great pairing with the quartet early to rise, is that idea of having the idea of change being sort of a seed which is built into the material, and that is, that becomes the piece. And so Safe Travels is similarly built on one of those patterns that modulates each time it's each time it repeats. And so it's a very, it makes for this very sort of unsettled feeling. It's constantly sort of growing and changing, and when it does move on to a new section, it's like another section which is constantly changing in a different way.
Okay.
And so you never really quite have the sense of being settled down or of resting in a place for too long. And when it does near the end have find this kind of low point that it keeps on returning to, it's still it's a kind of unresolved low point.
I see. Okay.
And then after it kind of hangs out there for a minute, it flies off to somewhere new, and then the piece is over.
So you never truly resolve, and you bring back the idea of going somewhere in a fleeting last gesture.
Yeah, and it was sort of the idea of Safe Travels. I mean, I kind of wanted to do a piece about traveling for Y Music because they're always on the road, they are such so widely traveled, and they make it they kind of make an art of it as much as any touring group that I know.
Oh, that's great. So we've talked about these two pieces and how they're kind of constructed, but what kind of sounds, what kind of colors, I like that word when talking about the sound of an ensemble or the sound of a piece, can our audience expect to hear from your music?
I know that's a very loaded question.
It's a very loaded question. I know. Maybe I can help in terms of what I'm thinking. Like, you know, your music is not atonal, right? But it's also it doesn't it doesn't exist necessarily in one tonal place very long.
Well, I think thinking about it in terms of tonality may be slightly misleading. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would say I'm a very harmonic composer. Right. Harmony is sort of the thing that first attracting me to music.
Okay.
Was hearing verticality, hearing a confluence of different notes that made up a chord, and thinking that is really beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I want to make that. I remember that feeling. I remember having that feeling when I was as young as 6 or 7.
Wow.
And I'm still kind of obsessed with harmony in my pieces, but I don't think about it too technically. Mm-hmm. I'm a very seat of the pants composer in some ways.
Okay.
I know the kind of harmonies that I like, and I know sort of from experience where things go in a piece, and I don't really plan it too extensively in advance. I just sort of start at the beginning and right to the end. And harmony is really part of that. It's like there are harmonic ideas implied in whatever material I choose. Mm-hmm. And the sort of conflict that can arise from those is for me integral to the entire conception of the piece.
Mm-hmm. So then that's fascinating. So what then do you have any influences, compositional influences? Are there particular composers or ensembles that you're attracted to and may or may not have had an influence on your own voice?
Oh, I mean, where to start with that question?
Okay, of course, but
it's impossible to say. I mean, I think there's a sense in which we're all sort of attracted to sounds that we've heard before, mm-hmm. that we know and love, and that. Yes, everything I do. If I were to take apart the individual components of any of my pieces and trace them back to their influence in my life, mm-hmm. you could say like, oh, this piece is just an assembly of, 50 or 100 different yeah. things that I've known and loved over the course of my life.
Right.
And, that's fine. I don't particularly claim to have originated anything.
Okay, yeah.
And I think trying to do that is kind of not what inspires me. But
that's also very tricky to do, I would imagine, instead of just speaking your voice.
Well, yes, and I think a voice is kind of what things do you put in that assembly, mm-hmm. and how are they arranged? And for me, often what I find is I'll be influenced by something and sort of inspired by it, and in setting out to figure out just what about it. That thing that I love, like how is it put together, like how is it made, setting out to imitate it, I will miss the mark and sort of end up with my own version of it, mm-hmm. or my own totally corrupted version of it. And I think that's actually I have this theory that's a lot of the way that any artist figures out their own voice, mm-hmm. Is by sort of setting out to imitate something and failing.
That's interesting. Yeah.
So I don't have really any anxiety about trying to do that.
Well, your music is incredibly beautiful. I mean, you've talked about the intensity of and the resolution of your music a little bit in some of the pieces we talked about. But for me, when I'm listening to your music, I find it incredibly lush and beautiful and rich and harmonic. The word harmonic comes to mind, of course, and you mentioned that. And it's such a pleasure to listen, but also it's not like anything I'm used to hearing as well. My ear is constantly intrigued. And I liked what you said about Safe Travels, where it just is always evolving, because when I'm listening, I got that sensation that it hadn't settled yet.
Right.
And it's incredibly beautiful, that feeling, because it's very different from the traditional sense of listening to chamber music or classical chamber music, to use that definition of what we do. But but to have that sensation of listening and being taken somewhere and not reaching the kind of standing points that our ears have grown accustomed to through repetition. It's a really lovely feeling.
Well, I thanks for that interpretation, because that's very much something that I was going for. I think, I've been thinking about this idea of sort of coming from a place musically, and for me, the place that I come from is very much the classical canon. Mm-hmm. I grew up studying piano very seriously.
And you're actually a very accomplished pianist, still actively performing it. You're not just a composer.
I do still perform.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah, that's great.
Sort of not really half my time, but maybe a third of my time is spent as a performer. Mm-hmm. But that world of being immersed in the piano literature, and then a little later the chamber music literature and orchestral, that was sort of what obsessed me growing up. And I didn't much feel the need to look beyond that until I was a little older. Mm-hmm. As you can imagine, I was a very, very popular kid in school. so that, I mean, there's an idea, I think now, of course, there are tons of different influences piled on top of that, mm-hmm. but this idea of how sort of classical and romantic music are put together, especially from a sort of traditional idea of craft, mm-hmm. of compositional craft, is still something that really obsesses me. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of what I would call my home base in a way.
Well, that's a nice way to talk about this next thing, because you're going to be here in Ottawa very soon, and you're also going to be honored at the Glenn Gould Foundation event here with the National Arts Center Orchestra on November 26th. So for those who don't know, the Glenn Gould Foundation is celebrating the work of Philip Glass here at the NAC. At this event, he will be awarded a Lifetime Achievement Award, and as part of that award, Glass is given the opportunity to award another Glenn Gould Foundation prize, the Protégé Prize. This prize is awarded to, quote, an outstanding young artist who shows the promise of an exceptional lifetime contribution to enriching the human condition through the arts, unquote, close quote. It seems like it's quite the honor to be chosen by someone like Philip Glass. It speaks to
For sure.
your already incredible success as a composer and performer. Can you tell us about the moment you found out you were the recipient of this award?
I got an email.
Yeah.
Just an email that sort of popped up in my inbox, and when you get an email that says, "Hey, you've won a prize," you're automatically a little suspicious.
Right. It sounds like it could have been a scam that didn't get through your junk filter, right?
Yeah. So I immediately forwarded it to my manager. I was like, "Do you need to know anything about this?"
And it's quite a prestigious prize. It's amazing.
I know. And I did some Googling and I saw the Gustavo Dudamel and like these crazy people have gotten this prize before. I was kind of overwhelmed by it. I think especially, getting it from Philip, who's someone I've admired for a long time and actually gotten to work with a bit mm-hmm. the past few years. It's just it's like such a Philip thing. I mean, he's sort of quietly one of the most supportive forces in the music world. Mm-hmm. The amount that he does for young musicians and musicians from all over the world, and not just composers or classical musicians, but all across the musical landscape. Mm-hmm. His benevolent influence and presence can be felt, and he doesn't make a big deal out of it. But this is the kind of thing that I think he's really beloved for within the music world, besides, mm-hmm. of course, his artistic contribution to the mm-hmm. field. So, I feel very grateful to be a part of that.
It's great, and the nice thing about it is, as for our Wolfgang concert, unfortunately, it's the week before you're here, but we get to highlight your music there. And the next weekend, you get to receive this award with Glenn Gould. With Philip Glass also receiving the award.
Oh, and Glenn gonna be there?
Yeah, I know, right? talk about a slip. The Glenn Gould Foundation is the
always
presenter.
Wanted to meet that guy.
I know. Can you imagine? Anyway, so we're gonna be playing some of Philip Glass's music, and you'll be there. And so it's kind of a nice event that this Lifetime Achievement Award is being presented to Philip Glass, but also for you, that it speaks to what he views as something, what he views as the future, what your music, for instance, that he's recognizing your work, your voice, your music as something that we should all be keeping an eye on, that it's something that has great importance for him already. I think that's kind of great. That, I mean, to have a Protégé prize, it seems like...
Well, it's very much sort of the way that the music world has always worked.
Yeah.
In that, someone with maybe an older artist, a more established artist with a big platform, big audience, will use that to sort of bring attention, much as like, if you're like Radiohead or some big touring act, you'll want to give the opening slot to like a younger, less established group that you know.
Yeah.
So it feels a little bit like that.
It's great. It's fantastic. And I know we're all really looking forward to that. So for you though, what have you got any exciting upcoming projects that we can keep our eye out for? I think I saw you have a BSO commission, right? Has that happened yet?
I'm actually going to Boston tomorrow.
Oh, wow. Great.
So that's sort of the thing that's, front and center. That piece, I wrote it maybe about 6 months ago. So it's been done for a little while and I'm very, very curious to hear it. And of course, thrilled to be working with the Boston Symphony.
Of course, yeah. That's fantastic. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Other than that, I'm sort of in the final stages of a two piano concerto.
Okay.
So that's two pianos and orchestra. That'll be done in February in London.
Okay.
So I'm just finishing that up.
Great. Fantastic. Well, thanks for joining us today. It's been great chatting with you. And
my pleasure. Thank you, Sean.
Huge fan of your music, and I hope our audience will check out your website. It's www.andres.com, and you can find a lot of Timo's music there, upcoming events. You can learn more about him. And if you're in Ottawa on the 19th of November or the 26th or both, please come check out these concerts. Wolfgang will be at the Mercury Lounge on November 19th. And we will have the Glenn Gould Foundation event on November 26th at the National Arts Center. Thanks again, Timo.
Take care. See you then.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.